This conference will
That's
now
actually
be
it gets
recorded.
generated and it can be stored. What else? Transaction processing also can happen. What about abstract classes? Can we create a transaction ID at abstract classes?
No.
No, that is what cannot be instantiated, and even it cannot be stored. Okay, so I'll come to the test connection button after some time. Let's log into our application. What is that? That is, I'm sorry. Jevco.com. Okay, password. Okay, so here you go. This is the application and that we have created, and these are the classes that have been created. Okay, so yesterday we were discussing about this. This one you call it as? What is this called as? This is class group. How many classes are there? Three classes: JEVC, JEVC hyphen Jevco VEH, JEVC hyphen Jevco VEH hyphen work. So these are the classes that have been created. So these three classes together is a class group. Okay, I have told you yesterday, class group is the one where in which your transaction can be initiated, transaction IDs can be created only in class group. Even though it is a concrete class, in PRPC we cannot create a that particular instances and all. Transaction IDs cannot be created. Transaction IDs can be created only within a class group. A concrete class, if it has to create a transaction ID, it must be a class group. This is the statement I ask you to remember. Class group must be one second. Class group must be inheriting from OOTB class, one of the OOTB class. What is that OOTB class? What is that? I'm asking the name of the class. Work dash or child classes of work dash is also okay. This is their online resources. A class group must be inherited from OOTB class work dash or any of child classes of work dash is also okay. Okay, so this is what we had discussed. At this point we are going to elaborate now. Now look at here. This is implementation application related class group. Can we access framework application and framework application related class group also from implementation application? It is possible because implementation is created on top of framework. So if you log into implementation, you'll be able to access implementation, you'll be able to access framework. For that you can see here, when you log in, how many applications you are seeing? Three applications. If you click on this link, you can see the names of the three applications. What is the name of first application? First application, Pega platform. On top of Pega platform, we have framework application. On top of framework application, we have implementation. This is how we have created while we are creating. Okay, so now here you go. Now, for every application that has been created by us, that is framework application and implementation application, PRPC creates class group. For framework application, if you wanted to see the class group, you backspace up to here. Organization class is same for framework and implementation, right? Hyphen, you give a FW, you should see something ending with work. Okay, four classes. So here FW gives you a sense that this class group is related to framework application. That's why one more class is added. Now if you right click on this and then definition, this is a concrete or abstract class? Concrete class, and this is a class group. And scroll down, and here you can see this is deriving from work dash or its subclasses. Okay, let me draw this as a diagram. Okay, here you go. This is one class. This is another class. Let's say this is work dash or subclasses. Okay, and this is JEVC hyphen JEVCO VH hyphen work. This is implementation class group, and this one JEVC hyphen FW hyphen, let's say JEVCO I hyphen work. This is framework class group. Within framework application, this is an implementation application, and these two are deriving from like this. Narrating from work dash, same class. Both definitions, if you see, so a class group must be derived from work dash or any of its subclasses that is been satisfied by default. We didn't do anything here. Everything is automatically created. That's what we are understanding. Now, what is the purpose of framework application? Generally, you tell me. You are not required to think about multiple servers and all. In one server, one application, you tell me. With respect to the implementation, what we have created, what is the purpose of framework for this implementation? What is available? The functionalities which we have made available in framework can be used in implementation application. So in Pega, it works like this. If you create application on top of application, it doesn't mean that you can access everything, whatever it is available in framework application being accessible to implementation application. Implementation application should be created on top of framework application, plus classes also should have relation. Without classes having relations, it cannot be able to use it. So if an application is using the rules of another application, means the classes of within child application should inherit from parent application. So if you take the parent application, anything which is available in parent application, if it has to be utilized by child application, whatever the classes that are available in parent application should be accessible to child application classes. How a class can access another class? By means of inheritance. So inheritance relation should be defined. Now, from the current structure, what is by default created? Implementation application should be able to access the components of work dash class. Okay, and framework application should be able to access the components of work dash class. But implementation application, can it access the components of framework application? Is that being possible or not possible from the current structure? Implementation application can access or cannot access? Cannot access framework application class related rules, because as of now we have seen there is no relation defined between the classes. Okay, now my requirement is like this. We have to change this diagram structure. This diagram we have to change it such that your implementation should be able to access framework classes, plus it should be able to access even work dash also, and your framework should be able to access work dash. That's how you need to change the diagram. So what is the change that we have to make here? Yeah, what is the change in the diagram, you tell me?
Create a connection between JEVCO work and connection between the implementation class and the framework class.
Implementation class and framework. So implementation inheriting from framework. Implementation is now inheriting from framework. Okay, so anything else we need to change? You make this connection. What else we need to change? What else we have to change? First, tell me one thing. This is what type of inheritance? The one which you have told just now. What type of inheritance? This is direct inheritance. That means you are saying, here you come to this PRPC screens and all. Let me access the implementation application class. That is, where is it? This one. So you are saying in this class, you have to go ahead and mention framework class group as a parent class. That means what should be removed? What is already available should be removed, right? We cannot mention two classes. That means in this diagram, you have to remove this connector. Is this required anymore? This connector is no more required. Suppose if I remove this connector, previously what was the inheritance available with this connector? Still that is being achievable here or not? Is that being achievable or not? That is being achievable. How come? Through framework. Now your implementation is deriving from framework. Framework is deriving from work dash. That means your implementation is also deriving from work dash. Previously, implementation from work dash, framework from work dash. That means implementation classes are not able to use framework classes. Now I have removed the connector between implementation and work dash and changed it to implementation, changed it from implementation to framework. So now your implementation can utilize the components of framework class group, plus it can utilize components of work dash. Parent of parent is also parent. Similarly, how it was available previously, framework utilizing from work dash is also there. So by default, PRPC will not give you this structure. So for this, we need to make a change. What is the change that we have to make in the class rule form? Where is it? The open implementation class group, right click on it and go to definition, and here you need to click the down arrow. So now you see JEVC hyphen FW hyphen. So now your implementation class group is deriving from framework class group. Framework class group is deriving from work dash. Does it mean your implementation class group is also deriving from work dash? But it is not direct. It is again direct inheritance by means of another child class. Your framework is now child class of work dash. Class group must be derived from work dash or child class of work dash. Is that satisfied? That is satisfied or not? That is also satisfied. So by default, PRPC is not giving this update. So we need to make changes accordingly, taking the framework. Suppose now you create anything in framework class group should be accessible to implementation class group. Everyone clear? This is one change that we have to make. For this, there is a document available which I'll share you. So in the document, same classes will not be available, another classes. Okay. But you should understand from your application. Okay, this is clear. That is theory part. So only this is the change that we have to make. So this is about class groups. When you create a new application, PRPC has created an application. PRPC has created one class group by default for each application. Can we have more than one class group? We can create our own class groups also, no issues. Okay, a number of classes, class groups you can create. It depends on your business. Okay, we'll see how to create other classes and all going forward. Okay, so this is clear, everyone. So a class group can create your transactions, and it must have to be inherited from work dash or any of its subclasses, means child class of work dash. By default, when you create a new application of framework and implementation, framework application and implementation application both are deriving directly from work dash or its work dash, let's say. But in order to access the components which are available in framework into implementation, we have made a change that we have opened implementation class group and given framework class group as a parent, where framework class group is deriving from work dash. So ultimately now your implementation class group is also deriving from work dash by means of framework class group. Okay, so this is the change that we have to make. Up to this is the theory that we have to discuss about application creation and all. Okay, let's keep this aside and we'll proceed forward. Everyone clear about inheritance, types of inheritance that we have discussed yesterday? What is the purpose of pattern inheritance? First of all, how a pattern inheritance been recognized between the classes? By class name separated with or concatenated with hyphen. That is what pattern inheritance. And pattern inheritance purpose is to reuse the components from user defined classes. Purpose of direct inheritance is redefined classes. But here direct inheritance, we are giving one of the user defined class. This is user defined or predefined? This is user created when you create new application. But through user defined, again, ultimately I am reaching to direct inheritance. This is clear. So I want to tell you one point here, whether you understand it or not, If you understand, remember, otherwise you leave it. Going forward in the practical, you'll be able to understand. Generally, in any inheritance, parent of parent is parent to child, grandchild or not. That you are aware of, right? Suppose one class is there, child class parent is there, parent class parent will be accessible to grandchild. This is true in any technology. Now, let's say A, okay, I will draw it as a diagram, okay? This one also diagrammatically available in the document. Now here you go. Let's say you have, let me write down simply, class A, okay? And in this, class B and class C. Let's say class D. Like this, there are a number of classes available. Here you go with, so class A, pattern, this small line is pattern inheritance, okay? And here you go, thin one, this is thick one I'm going to choose. This means direct inheritance. I want to represent direct inheritance like this. Thick line means direct inheritance, thin line is pattern inheritance. Now for class D, class C is parent. In what type of inheritance? Pattern. For class C, what is the parent class? Class B. What inheritance? Pattern. For class D, class A is parent. What type of inheritance? Direct inheritance. Class D can access anything which is available in class C and class B, but not class A. See, parent of parent is going to become parent to grandchild in Pega only when the inheritance type is up to the inheritance type match. Anywhere in between broken, up to that, after that it cannot access. So pattern parent is parent to ground level. Direct parent is parent to ground level. Anywhere in between it is changing, it cannot become a parent class. So a pattern parent's direct parent is not parent to grandchild. A direct parent's pattern parent is not parent to grandchild. That's how PRPC is designed. This is clear? So it is very simple to remember. Parent class, if you see, type of inheritance should match. Up to that only it will take. Anywhere type of inheritance is broken with another type being added, then it should not be able to access the components. We'll practically see that going forward. Okay. Okay, now here you go. Let's go ahead and talk about what we're going to work on. So this is the understanding about all this. Again, I will tell you what is class group later. Class group, whatever the definition I have told you, class group is the one where transactions can be created and it must be inherited from work dash. Apart from inheriting work dash, transactions, this is functional definition. Technically, I'll tell you while we're working, okay? So what are we going to work on from today is, we're going to work on user interface. So what did we learn yesterday or today is, we talked about types of classes and we talked about inheritance, types of inheritance and all. We talked about class group and we changed inheritance between FW and IMPL class groups. We have modified the default one. That's it. Okay. So this is what we have discussed so far. Let's go ahead and talk about user interface. So we are going to work on UI, we are going to work on business DB, we're going to look at business logic, all this. Nothing is programming here, everything is OTP or drag and drop like that. See, UI we are going to work on starting from today, maybe next Tuesday or Thursday we will be working on user interface and database after that, and then business logic integratively will work on everything. Okay, this is how we are going to proceed forward. So here you go. Let me go ahead and log into existing application to show you user interfaces and all. Hey, online resources, we have 39 resources online, right? Just give me 1 minute. 39 means it should be 38 by number. We have only 37 names here. And I want to tell you strictly, never share the meeting link to anyone outside our students. And never share the meeting link in WhatsApp group also. It will be shared to you only on your personal personal WhatsApp inbox. Never share it in group or never share it outside. Okay, this is one thing. And online resources, you'll be receiving a message today, personal message, mentioning how to mention your name on GoToMeeting. Exactly, you have to follow the same naming convention. Just try to cooperate. And apart from that, Just give me 1 minute. I need to quickly check who is connecting. And Chainath. I don't see your name mentioned here. What is the reason? Maybe we are missing it or what? What is your WhatsApp number? Chainath. What is the WhatsApp number? Pavluri. Are you available? If you are saying something that is not audible, can you please give a message on WhatsApp quickly? China, can you please ping your WhatsApp number here on GoToMeeting at least? No. No, I'm asking about Chainath. Are you available online? Okay, 96. Let me check that. Maybe I'm missing. You are there in group? Okay, fine. Okay, let me check quickly. Devinder, Janam. Firoz, Gopi, Hari. Firoz. Gopinath. Hari Hinsum. Hari Hinsum. Indar Ayapan Karthi. Indar Ayapan Karthi. And Kasi Reddy Vinay. Is your name Vinay or Kasi Reddy? We have noted as Vinay. From tomorrow, use Vinay. Okay. Who is Kavita? Kavita, are you available there? Madhuri Manoj Martin, Madhuri Manoj Martin, Mona, Munindar Murali Parameshwar, Munindar Murali Parameshwar, and then Raghav Rajkumar Sahiti. Rajkumar Sahiti Ramana. Who is Ramana here? Online. Ramana Reddy. You are connecting? Okay, fine. I got you. Okay. And Samir, Sandeep, Satendram, Shiva, Shoni, Srihari, Shiva, Srihari, Sohini, Sohini, I'm sorry. Okay, Sohini, Sudam, Vasudev, Venkatrao, Swati, Vidya, Vijay, Vinay, Ashwant. Right, 37 the date. Okay, count is matching, that's fine. Chainath, right? I have saved your name as Chainath. I'll change it. Okay, and now let's proceed forward, and we're going to work on UI. So here you go. Venkatrao is Sai Sujita. Sai Sujit. Is that you, Sujit? Venkatrao is Sujit. Okay, fine.
Yeah.
Fine. You mention your name as Sujit from tomorrow. I'll add you to group. And now,
okay.
So, yeah, thank you very much. And here you go. See, anything you create in VRBC, it must be integrated ultimately into workflow. Let me show you one of the workflow. Here you go. Right. So we're going to see how to create a workflow as well. Here you go. This is the flow that is already available. So whenever you are going to invoke your flow, flow is going to talk to user interface or business logic, or maybe it will also talk to database and all, everything will be performed. So the UI that has been displayed here, okay, if you wanted to open it in design time, let's go here and right click on this and open flow action. You don't bother about the navigations. I'll give you navigations later. You have to understand what rules we have to create. So look at here. So this is the design phase of the UI, what you have seen here at runtime. Okay, this is the design type environment. So here you go. If you wanted to design user interface, generally you can use JSP or you can use ASP, you can use plain HTML coding and all. So in PRPC, HTML gets auto-generated. It's a form-based programming model. You are being given with controls. If you want a button control, generally you have to type something like type control is equal to button, label is equal to something like that. But here you just simply drag and drop, button will be created and you can do perform the alignments accordingly. Okay, so now if you wanted to design user interface, you need to create a rule called section. That rule name is section. You have to create a rule called section. Section is like a HTML rule in HTML technology. In HTML, you're going to write HTML open tag, HTML closed tag. In between, there will be a lot of content. Overall HTML, you consider it as a section here. Inside HTML, what you write? Body, controls and all you're going to define, right? So the one what you see here, text input, radio buttons, buttons, drop downs, these are all controls, HTML controls. So HTML coding, inside that controls coding, everything you will get by simple drag and drop and all. Now, the one what you see here, dynamic layout, this one, you can use it for the purpose of alignment. One of the primary purpose, there are multiple purposes. Suppose if I change it to inline grid triple, as of now, in the background, you see two columns, multiple rows. Suppose if I change it to inline grid triple and submit this, now you got three columns. So tell me one thing, if you wanted to align the controls in HTML programming, those who are already aware of, you just tell me how to align the controls in HTML programming. By using table, you are going to write table data, something like. So here the layout is equal to table element, what you are going to use in your HTML program. So if you wanted to write design UI, you have to write HTML coding in other programming languages. So in HTML, you have table for aligning the controls. You have controls being defined. Same concept. Section is equal to HTML. Layout is equal to table. Controls are controls. What is there? You simply drag and drop. This is clear, everyone. So if you wanted to design UI, you have to create a rule called section. When you create a new section, I will give you the navigations later. Just simply see. Anything you are creating, it must have a name. Okay, it can be any name. Let's say test section. So this is label, means display name. Identifier is actual name of the rule. Actual name, create and open. By default, you'll see empty section like this. So what it says, it is a dynamic layout. If you have any properties, you drag and drop here. Okay, just look at here. I'll tell you about this in few minutes, what is the property and all. So here I'm going to get into, and I'm going to drag and drop something. First name, drag and drop. And here go with gender, drag and drop. And state, drag and drop. So these are called properties. Everything what you see here on the screen is created by me. We will see how to manually create all this. But first, let's understand what are these components and all. Now here, I drag and drop first name, and I have drag and drop gender and radio buttons. What are these things that I have dragged and dropped? So as it says, drag and drop any number of properties. So I have drag and dropped a property. Leave about other context, this one. Other text you leave about properties. So I have drag and dropped a property. So that means if you wanted to design UI, before you create section, what you should have to create? Property should be readily available, whether it is the one you create or it might be provided by Pega itself. Okay, but ultimately you should have properties ready in hand. Then next thing that you have to do is HTML means section. Okay, section you have to create, drag and drop the properties into section, which is making controls. First name, when I drag and drop, it has given me text input control. It is appearing like text input control. When you drag and drop gender, it is appearing like radio buttons. When you drag and drop state, it is appearing like a drop down. At runtime, you'll see the values being populated into drop down. how process commander knows that gender, it has to take radio buttons. For state, it has to take drop down, and for first name, it has to take text input. That is, look at here. I will open the property. This is first name, gender, and then state. I have opened the role form. So here you go. You see, first name is of type property. This is a property, and here it has been associated with a control. Okay, leave about the context px, prefix px, just talk about this one, text input. Suppose you open gender, it is associated with what control? Radio button. Male and female are defined here as a local table, and state drop down values you will get runtime dynamically. Okay, so every property is associated with a control, UI control. See, if you click the down arrow here, you see n number of controls available in PRPC by default. Text area, text input, radio buttons, drag something like this, scroll bar, menus like this, n number of controls are already available. Okay, so whenever you are going to create a property, you associate a property with a control. What is the purpose of control? Now, how this property should be visible when it is taken into the design phase of UI will be decided by the control what is available at the property. So if the property control is text input, when you drag and drop that property into HTML, means section, it appears like section. So when you drag and drop a property which has a control associated is radio buttons, when you drag and drop that property into section, then that is going to appear like radio buttons. When you drag and drop a property of drop down, that is going to appear like drop down. Okay, so while you are creating property, you will give property name and you will give a control being associated according to your requirement. Business will tell you what control you have to use for which property. Okay, now property has a name and property has a type. Property type text, property type integer, property type decimal, property type, let's say password type, or property type can be, there are other different types available. Okay, date, date time, like this, there are different property types available. Suppose you go back to C language, this property type, what I have told now, text property type, decimal, date, date time, this is equivalent to what in C language?
Data types.
What is equivalent to this one in data in C language or HTML or anywhere? What do you call it as? You call it as data type. It is called data type. So in C language, when you come across with data type is associated with which one? What programming components will have data type being associated?
Variables.
So variables will be associated with data type. Variable will have a name. Variable is associated with data type. When you are going to design UI, you associate this variable with a control in the UI. Generally, same concept here also. Now, property is just like a variable in any other programming languages, which is going to hold a value at runtime. Okay. So now a property will have a name. It is going to have a property type which is equal to data type in other programming languages, and it is also associated with a control. When you take the property to UI design, it is going to appear like what is the control available on the property. This is clear. So first we need to create properties, identify all the required properties, and then create and make it available. And then you create section, simply drag and drop these properties into the section. This is one of the approach. I'll tell you other approaches later. Okay, other way of design later. Okay, everyone clear? Next, you are done with section creation. Okay, section is ready. Section means UI. Ultimately, you create UI or business logic or database that must have to be integrated into another component in Pega. What is that? That is called workflow or process. You have to integrate into flow. You just go to flow here. This is the flow. If you wanted to call UI, means you are expecting user's interaction, a human interaction. A human can interact with a software application when you are being provided with any kind of user interface. It can be HTML, it can be mainframes, black and white screens, whatever it is. As a human, if you wanted to interact with the application, any software application, you need user interface. Otherwise, you cannot interact, right? Now, you can also interact by phone calls and all. That is a different thing. Just basically, basic idea is UI, okay? Now, UI, if you wanted to integrate into UI, if you wanted to integrate into workflow, that means you're expecting human interaction on the transaction. So if you wanted to integrate UI into workflow, you need a flow shape. There are a number of flow shapes available in workflow. The one which is starting shape, start shape, and the other one is end shape. Whenever you are going to run the workflow, means you are initiating your transaction. So your transaction gets initiated at start shape, your transaction gets resolved or completed at end shape. How many start shapes can we have for a transaction? Can we have more than one start shape? Is it possible? Only at one start shape is possible in a workflow. How many end shapes can be there? Is it one or more? Can we have one or more end shapes or only one always? Okay, we can have one or more end shapes. How come? Decision. While your transaction is being processed, conditionally you want it to end in different directions. Okay, condition one, end with certain end in direction one. Condition two, end in different direction. Condition three, different direction. So a workflow can have one, should have one and only one start shape. It can have at least one end shape, means it can be one or more. In between there will be a number of flow shapes. Your transaction gets started at start shape and your transaction gets completed when it reaches any one of the end shape. This is clear? Now see, in between the flow shape, what you see here, green color, this one, this is called assignment shape. A workflow provides access to multiple different flow shapes. I'll talk about different flow shapes later. As of now, we're going to talk about assignment shape. If you wanted to add a new flow shape, you can right click on the ground and add, you will get a number of flow shapes. Or you have a palette here, in the palette also you have a number of flow shapes. This is just for your information. Now let's talk about assignment shape. This is assignment shape. Label, you can change it. Okay, what do you mean by assignment, first of all? What do you mean by assignment? Generally, what do you mean by assignment? Task. Assignment means it is a task that you are going to assign to someone. If you want to assign a task to human, then you need assignment shape. Humans will interact with application by using UI. That means if you wanted to integrate user interface into workflows, you need a flow shape. That is assignment shape. This is clear, everyone? Okay. So using an assignment shape, you can call user interface. You can integrate UI into workflow. You create a workflow, take an empty assignment, integrate your UI created into workflow. So this is the connection. It is just like a template. Ultimately, if you wanted to design a user interface and you make it available at runtime, the steps that you need to follow is, first step, you need to create all the properties. And the second step is get the property, create a section, drag and drop the properties into section. And then you need to, anything you create, you have to integrate into flow. So you create a flow, integrate your UI into flow. This is the requirement. Okay, this is how you have to do. Now, if you go back to this UI, in the basic UI that you see here, we have all the controls, first name, last name, all this. This has been already integrated into this flow. When I run this flow, I've got UI that I have created being displayed. Apart from that, you have cancel button, you have save button, you have submit button. Leave about other portions of UI, only bother up to here. But in the UI that we have designed, that is already designed and available, do you have that buttons available here? Even though you did not add buttons, it is automatically giving the buttons of submit, save, cancel. These are OTP already available in Pega. Now look at here. I'll enter some information. And if I submit, it is going to the next level in the flow. Next level of assignment or maybe any other, another shape, it is available, it will display. And then submit this, it will go to the next level in the workflow and it will display another user. So it will go step by step processing. This is what multi-step transaction, step one, step two, step three, step four, and finally it ends. So here I have called UI, here I have called UI, here I have called UI. Okay. So now if you wanted to integrate UI into workflow, you need a flow shape called assignment shape. And in the UI that we have created, we don't have buttons and all. These are automatically coming. Can you tell me what is the purpose of this button? What does this button will perform generally? Why, when you wanted to add buttons into your user interface, whenever you wanted to perform an action, you want to perform an action. So when you click on this button, it will perform an action. What is that action? Submit. When you click on this button, it is going to cancel this one. And when you click on this button, it will only perform save. The submit is equal to save plus commit into database. This is going to just perform as save. Leave about save. Just understand only submit and cancel. Submit means it will complete this and proceed forward. Cancel means without completing, it will cancel this particular assignment. Okay. So these buttons are automatically coming. How these buttons are coming? See, these buttons are giving a facility of performing an action on the UI that is being displayed. When you submit, when you perform submit action, it will proceed forward to next level in the flow. When you cancel, it will be canceled there itself. So if you want to add an action to the UI, by default, PRPC has added the action. You did not add it. How come? See, in your workflow, assignment shape outward connector. If I go to properties, I can see something here. What do you see here? Flow action. There is a rule called flow action. What is the name of your section? Name of the section is customer details SEC. Okay, let me open the flow action. When I open the flow action, this is flow action. Inside flow action, what is called? Section is called. So your properties are integrated into section. Your section is integrated into flow action. Your flow action is integrated into flow. Section you cannot directly add into flow. After you create section, you have to create another rule called flow action. Flow action is the only one you can call into flow. Now, what is flow action meaning? Tell me functional meaning from the name. What is flow action? If you wanted to perform an action in the workflow, you need a flow action. A flow action holds a section. It is like a container of section which will add action to the user interface that you have created. For the UI that you have created, you have not added any action. Pega is automatically adding an action of submit, save, cancel. How that is been added? Because you have integrated your section into flow action. Call the flow action into flow. So these are the steps. See, if you wanted to design UI and make it available at runtime as a web page, you need to first create properties and then create a section, drag and drop the properties into section, and then create a flow action, include the section into flow action. So here section is container of properties, flow action is container of section, and this flow action you call it into flow by using assignment shape outward connector. Outward connector, look at here now. This is assignment shape. It has two connectors. One is connector, what is inward connector, another one is outward. If you double click on inward connector, you don't see any option like flow action here. You don't see anything like flow action. And if you double click on the connector which is outward from assignment, do you see an option? Flow action. So flow action can be integrated into flow by using assignment shapes outward connector. This flow shape is different, utility. If you double click on utility shape outward, you don't see any flow action at all. Utility purpose is different. So each flow shape will have its own purpose. Okay. Me peru? Harsha Trainings. Me peru? On Pega Training. Prakash Reddy. Mere inquiry chesi vachara? Classes start ayipoyindi. 5 days అయింది ఒక 15 ఒక 10 మినిట్స్ వెయిట్ చేయండి మాట్లాడదాం మీరు క్లాస్ అయిపోయింది ఓకే ఫైన్ సో నౌ దీస్ ఆర్ ద బేసిక్ టెంప్లెట్ ఆఫ్ స్టెప్స్ దట్ ఐ హావ్ టోల్డ్ యూ జస్ట్ ఓకే వాట్ వి హావ్ డిస్కస్డ్ సో ఫార్ ఇస్ జస్ట్ బేసిక్ టెంప్లెట్ ఇఫ్ యూ వాంటెడ్ టు డిజైన్ ఎనీ యుఐ అండ్ మేక్ ఇట్ అవైలబుల్ ఇన్ యువర్ ట్రాన్సాక్షనల్ ప్రాసెసింగ్ సో దీస్ ఆర్ ద రూల్స్ దట్ యూ హావ్ టు క్రియేట్ ఇఫ్ నాట్ అవైలబుల్ ఇఫ్ అవైలబుల్ నో నీడ్ టు క్రియేట్ సో ప్రాపర్టీస్ ఐడెంటిఫై ఆల్ ద రిక్వైర్డ్ ప్రాపర్టీస్ ఆఫ్ యువర్ యుఐ and create those properties, give names, data types, associate them with the controls. Okay. And then create a section, drag and drop the properties into section. Then create a flow action, include the section inside flow action, and create a flow with an assignment shape and call the flow action into flow by using outward connector. So I will share you the document which has all these steps about properties, sections, flow actions, and all. So this is what we are going to work on practically. Creating, so we are going to learn with this class, we are going to learn how to create properties, how to create a section, how to create a flow action and flow and call flow action to flow. This and all we are going to learn with this session. Everyone clear with this? Tell me, what is a property? What is property? Property is just like a variable in other programming languages. which holds a value at runtime. What is section? Section is a HTML rule, can be used to design user interface. Flow action, functionally I'll tell you the definition of flow action now. Technical definition I'll tell you later. Flow action is a container of section which can be called into the flow, which will give an action to the section, which will add an action to the section like submit, cancel, save. Okay, what is the flow? Flow represents transactional processing in your application. Flow has the capability to initiate transaction and to create transaction IDs. This is clear, everyone? One more point I have to discuss. Everyone clear so far? See, terminology, flow, workflow, process, all these are same. Okay, the terminology of transaction, instantiation, I think we didn't come across so far. All this is something like similar. Okay, flow, workflow, process, anything is same. Now look at here. See, the document which I am going to share you, you will have one first point is there. That is, let me open the document first. Let's show you. This one, did I share you this document yesterday? No, right? So property sections. See, property is an instance of class rule obj property. Similarly, you will see one similar kind of point. You will see at all rules, section, flow action, and all. As of now, while you are going ahead now, you can ignore this. Okay, and I share you this document. Reading this point, you can ignore. I mean, understanding this point, you can ignore, because you will not be able to understand this at this point of time. I'll tell you later. Again, I'll come across with this later. This can be created under data model category. I have to tell you this. Property is just like a variable in other programming languages that you are aware of. Let me write down that scene. Property is just like a variable in other programming languages. It's associated with name. That is what ID. Name. What is that? Property type. Property type is equal to. But I am not going to write down data type in this document, because data type in Pega is different. Okay. Property type, you need to imagine like text or something like that. I'll write down here. Okay. Text, and then decimal, date, etc. Okay, like this. Data type, property type, and then control. Table type.
Controls.
Okay. So this is about property, and this can be created under data model category. Similarly, you look at here. Scroll down. You have something like section. Okay. I think I have written all this here again. And here you go with section. Section is a HTML rule used to design user interface. Okay, section is a HTML rule used to design UI. See, this is an instance of class. Similar point is there at property. You ignore this, and this can be created under user interface category. I will tell you this point in few minutes. Now here you go with flow action. So it's a container of section which adds an action to the UI. UI means section. Okay, it adds an action to the UI. This is clear. Again, you see the same point. I'll tell you later. This one we're going to discuss now. This can be created under process category. Flow. What is workflow? Defines transactional processing of our transactions. Okay, so flow will have different flow shapes. In that, I have talked about assignment shape and all. Here you should find out. Okay. Now coming to this one, in all these rules, when I have defined it, you see one of the common point which you can leave as of now, and another common point is property can be created under data model category, section can be created under user interface category, flow action can be created under process category. Similarly, flow can be created under process category. This is what I have written there. So the meaning of this statement talks about the navigation of how to create it. Look at here. What is our application? JEBCO. This one and rules. So here you go. So here you go to application. This is what we have. Now, if you right click on the class name, okay, class group name, you see create. Anything you wanted to create, this is the navigation. Right click on the class group and go to create menu. From create menu, the second menu, what you see here, this is categories menu. This is called rule categories. And the third menu is rule type, the rule what you are talking about. Okay, when I say property can be created under data model category, you have to go to create and then categories. Which category property under? Data model. When you get into data model category, you see one of the rule type that we are discussing is property. It's not only property under data model, there are many rule types. Second menu is what? Rule categories. Third menu is rule types, actual rules. Okay, so section can be created under user interface category, meaning that create category is user interface, and then you see something called section. This is clear, everyone? So similarly, create flow action. Flow action can be created under process category. Create process and then flow action. Similarly, flow also can be created under process category. That is the meaning of the statement. So and so rule can be created under so and so category. This is clear, everyone? So go through the document. This practical we are going to work on tomorrow. Okay, so this is basically, this is a template of steps. Anytime in future you are creating UI, this template you have to follow. Already properties are there, no need to create. Section is already there, you need to modify, modify. Flow action is already there, modify, modify, like this. Okay, either you create or you modify, it depends. Okay, but in order to design basic user interface, we need to first have create properties to be created, and then section to be available. Flow action, section should be integrated into flow action. Flow assignment shape outward connector, you can call the flow action. When you run the flow, it will invoke the flow action. UI will be displayed. That is your section, along with submit, save, cancel buttons. These submit, save, cancel buttons are coming from flow action. You submit, it will move to next level. This is clear, everyone? Now, coming back to this section, right? Okay, I'll talk about it okay tomorrow, but ask me any questions if you have. Anyone has any question? Just, sorry? I will talk about database saving and all later. Okay, once we design this complete and then we enter the information UI and submit, I'll talk about database. Save and submit, save will save, submit will save plus commit. Okay, I'll talk about in detail later. That's why I told you ignore save, cancel submit, you bother about. Okay, next, any other questions? Anyone has any questions, so any doubts? Yes, please. Danam, if you're asking something, you're not audible. Can you please send a message and go to
the YouTube clip? Now it is audible. Yeah, Harsha. Yeah, okay. Harsha, to create these properties, we had to create the application first, right? Without creating an application, we cannot create these properties. Yes.
Correct. Okay. Application and classes. Application should be there. Inside application, classes should be there. Within the classes, you create anything. Okay, classes by default we got same, we'll use. Going forward we'll create our own classes. Next, any other questions? Everyone clear with the just a template that we have discussed about? I didn't tell you much technical. I didn't tell you what is a flow action. Flow action is a process rule which moves the case from one assignment to the next level in the flow. This is technical definition, but I told you functionally. Flow action is like a container of section which will add an action to the UI. This is functional definition. Technical we'll see later.
What is exactly the difference between pattern and direct inheritance? Can you please tell me?
Okay, tell me what is the difference between pattern inheritance. You have understand what is pattern inheritance, what is direct inheritance. What is the difference between pattern and direct inheritance? There are few points. Direct inheritance is only one parent will be mentioned in direct inheritance, where it can be used to access predefined components, primary purpose. Pattern inheritance by class name, you can have one or more classes in the pattern. But direct inheritance, you cannot give comma and another class. Only one class to be mentioned. Okay, pattern there can be n number of pattern of classes. Pattern inheritance purpose is to access something user defined classes. Direct inheritance purpose ultimately to access from PRPCs OOTD. Clear?
Yes, got it.
And which is mandatory out of these two? Which inheritance is mandatory? Which inheritance is mandatory? Direct inheritance, if you are not giving any class name, it is throwing a message saying that it is mandatory. So direct inheritance is mandatory. Pattern inheritance, we can make it optional. I'll tell you later how to make it. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, I'll tell you one more point. Priority wise, pattern inheritance has highest priority than direct inheritance. Means whenever you are requesting for something, first it will look up pattern classes, then only it will go to direct classes after that. Why? Why it is designed like this? That is OTB. Why? Because first PRPC has to look up only user defined. Means your user defined can have a modified component of what is already predefined. Predefined you have taken, you modified and made it available in user defined classes. So which one it has to take at runtime? User defined. This point also you will be able to understand later slowly. It will take some time. Somebody asking question. Anyone? You can create transactions in framework class, class group. You can create transactions in implementation class group, because both are class groups, right? Either of the places you can create, but mostly we'll create transactions at implementation or framework. Implementation, and then we will access through framework. There are certain situations. Suppose if you use transaction creation from framework, it will be more dynamic, but your programming will be little complex the way you design. That is called dynamic class referencing. That's a different concept actually. Suppose I have different types of implementations. For all implementations, I want to initiate transaction at framework. But from framework, can you initiate transaction for implementation? Is it possible generally? Is it possible? Can you access something of implementation into framework? That is called dynamic class referencing. But that is the best ultimate way. But if I teach like that, you cannot understand anything. Okay. So we'll see that. But mostly you'll see transactions initiated from implementation only, 90%. Okay. It's not about concrete class. Direct inheritance is mandatory for every class, whether it is abstract or it is concrete. Go to class rule form, you have the direct inheritance option available. For abstract class also, you'll see that. Go ahead and see whether it is abstract or concrete. Any class, direct inheritance is mandatory. Okay, so fine, that's it. Tomorrow we'll discuss. If you have any questions, we'll discuss and we'll start practical tomorrow. And let me take a count. Online resources, you can exit the meeting. Offline resources, and 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 24, 28, 29, 30, 35, 41. Anyone is spending with fees payments offline? How many of you? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. ఈ రోజు కంప్లీట్ మీరు రేపటి నుంచి అయితే అటెండ్ అవ్వకూడదు. ఈ రోజు కంప్లీట్ చేస్తే దట్స్ ఓకే. ఫ్రమ్ టుమారో యూఆర్ నాట్ అలౌడ్ టు అటెండ్. ఇఫ్ యూ కమ్ ఆల్సో ఐల్ సెండ్ యూ బ్యాక్. ఓకే, ప్రాసెస్ ఈస్ ప్రాసెస్ ఫర్ ఎవ్రీ వన్. ఓకే, ఇట్ హ్యాస్ టు బి డన్. హౌ మెనీ? 1, 2. దట్ మీన్స్ యు ఆర్ స్టిల్ స్ట్రగ్లింగ్ టు జాయిన్ టు డిసైడ్ ఆర్ వాట్ ఎట్ టు డిసైడ్. ఎట్ టు డిసైడ్ మీన్స్ స్టే బ్యాక్ అట్ యువర్ హోమ్, థింక్, డిసైడ్ and then join next batch. Okay, no worries. I have given almost 5 to 6 days to decide whether to join or not. Tomorrow onwards, not allowed, strictly not allowed anyone. Thank you very much for joining. You can wind up for today. Online, if someone is asking question, I'll see that tomorrow.
No, I'm just, it's a general, where we can find this recordings?
I will tell you, Devender, this one you're going to learn going forward. Okay, what parent class at what time, and slowly you are going to gain that knowledge. అవునా చెప్తానే. యాక్చువల్లీ మాకు పార్కింగ్ ప్లేస్ ఉండేది విడిగా, వాళ్ళు కన్స్ట్రక్షన్ చేసే పాటికి ఇప్పుడు పార్కింగ్ ప్లేస్ దొరకలేదు. ఇటువైపు పెట్టుకోవచ్చు. everyone, you should complete the form also. I forgot to tell you this. Academic fields are given here. Mandatory fields. We pay room. Sharanya. It is from Chayala. How can I help just that? A room lot of machine. So 9 o'clock batch is just hang on because of new batch. We are just getting delayed a little bit. మీరు గ్రూప్ లో లేరు కదా అది బ్రాడ్కాస్ట్ కి వస్తుంది గ్రూప్ లో ఉంటే మీకు తెలుసు ఇక గ్రూప్ ఉందా లేదా గ్రూప్ లో మీ పేమెంట్ వన్ టైం ఆర్డర్